Welcome back.
Oh, don't you dare look back. Just keep your eyes on me. I said you're holding back. She said, shut up and dance with me. This woman is my destiny. She said, ooh, ooh, shut up and dance with me. We were victims of the night.
Hello. And welcome to episode 22 of KnitSense. My name is Jan, and you can find me as Jan Ellen RN on Ravelry, on Instagram, on Facebook. That's primarily where I am. And we do have a group on Ravelry, the KnitSense podcast group. I will link it below. So please come and join us. I would love to have some activity on that board. I've got some great ideas for if we want to do some knit-alongs to get to know each other. So please come and join our group on Ravelry. Tour de Fleece is coming up, so that would be fun if you guys are interested in joining Tour de Fleece. I'm not, I don't have a team. I will be likely spinning for Team Into the World and Team Shacked, but we can certainly spin together and share what we're spinning and how we're spinning and different things. And as if you can't tell, I am heavy into the spinning right now. So I have a lot of that to share with you. So having said all of that, let's see, what is today? Today is Friday, and I'm going to say it's June 16th, but don't quote me on that. I seem to have lost track of the days about 2 weeks ago. So I know it's June, and I think it's the 16th, but it's Friday. So I hope you all are looking forward to a good weekend. Right now, this weather this week, it has been brutally hot. Now, for some of you that live in warmer climates, you're probably laughing going, you think that's brutal heat? And I know, I get it, I do. But to me, anything over 65, 70 at the most is hot, and anything over 80 is just unacceptable. So we were in the 90s for a good part of this week. Yesterday was kind of iffy. Today it is raining, it is gloomy. I'm grateful for the rain to wash some of this pollen away because allergies here have been horrendous, but at least that oppressive air is gone. So since this isn't a weather podcast, but a knitting podcast, why don't we just jump in? This week I have a little bit of knitting. I have now kind of been pushed my knitting into really at night in bed before I go to sleep because I have been completely preoccupied and obsessed with spinning, with fiber, with all of that. And I'll show you what I've been working on. But we do have some knitting. I have made some progress and we do have a lot of spinning and fiber prep stuff, and we have some stash enhancement, and what else? Some upcoming event, and I have a finished object, a knitted finished object. So let's jump right in, and let's go straight to the knitting first. Again, I'm sure people who have been podcasting longer or better or more consistently, which pretty much is anybody other than me, set things up in a normal way. I have piles here, piles, just piles of stuff. And if I pull something out the wrong way, it's all going to come flying out. So if you hear funny noises, things probably hit the floor. The scraping you're about to hear is me pulling the chair that I have another pile on over. Things are kind of set up a little kludgy, but I think I'm getting better at it. I haven't had a disaster in a couple of podcasts now. I don't think I've had anything really go wrong. So we're heading in the right direction. We seem to be getting better at it. So So without further ado, since I finished my May socks, which obviously that's my finished objects, I'll show you in a bit, I started my June socks for the Desert Vista Dye Works monthly sock club. And I'm doing a little bit of a different sock. I think all of the socks I've done so far have been vanilla socks. I did a flap and gusset heel on the first three or four, and I did a fish lips kiss heel on this one that I'm going to show you later, the finished one. And I'm not sure if that's the first or the second fish lips kiss heel, but either way, that's all I've done is the same flap and gusset heel and a fish lips kiss heel. And they're all vanilla socks. I didn't want to do patterns because the way I've actually been able to keep up with this and get it done is by doing this on the fly. This has been my go-to travel knitting, doctor's office knitting. That's primarily where this is getting done. So I didn't want anything complicated. I didn't want anything that I had to really think. This was just easy, and that's really how I've been able to keep up as well as I can, because we all know with knit-alongs, I'm either the last one coming in, bringing up the rear, or I don't even bother to finish it. So I'm on my July socks, and I decided that this time I was going to keep to the vanilla sock. I looked over the pattern, which is Vanilla is the New Black. And it turns out that it actually is a vanilla sock. So I was fine with that. I'm sorry, I just dropped the whole thing on the floor. I was fine with that, just to have to look up the heel, and the heel wasn't too complicated to be able to travel with. So I was okay with that. So first I have to say, I am completely obsessed with this color. I need more of this. This is the first finished sock. It is Desert Vista Dye Works. It is in the Sleeping Zombody colorway. And I knew it was self-striping, but when I first looked at the skein, I'm like, how can this, and again, please just ignore the nails. My ADD is so bad, I cannot even sit still for a manicure. And you can't knit while you're getting your nails done. So they're just horrendous, and I just don't care. So they look like garbage, and we'll let it go at that. But anyway, you know, I looked at the skein in the skein, and I couldn't see where it was self-striping, and I looked, you know, I put it, you know, wound it up, and I'm like, I still don't see it. It just sort of looks like pink and green with pops of, you know, maybe a little purple in there. And then when I started knitting with it, I was like, all right. Okay, that was my glasses that hit the deck. I knew it was going to happen, okay? Because like I said, there's just piles of crap all over the place here. Anyway, I finished the first sock. And it is self-striping. Yes, it is. It does. And look at how it stripes. It stripes with a light pink and a darker pink. And then that, I don't know if you call it like splatter in a purpley colorway and in a green colorway. I am obsessed. I am obsessed. I tried to order more last night and I couldn't find it on the website. Sorry, my phone rang. But anyhow, I couldn't find it on the website, so I'll have to see if I can special order it. But I did do the Vanilla is the New Black heel. It is a short row heel. I'm going to try to see if I can really show this the best I can. It's a short row heel, and you can see where the short row is, but it almost looks, if you look at it from the bottom, like it's kind of a gusset heel with the gusset on the bottom. So very hard to explain, but the upshot of it is that the heel is ribbing right here, as you can see. And I can't even explain. Let's see if I can try to get it on the heel of my hand. Maybe that will show it better. Like that. But it's a stretchy heel with no holes. There are no holes. And it was pretty easy to do because basically what you're doing is you're starting it here And you're basically just increasing a 2x2 rib until you get to however many stitches you cast on. It tells you in the pattern how many you need to get up to. And then you do the decreases, which kind of puts you back down to here in the sock. And then you just continue on the foot. But while you're doing the decreases, if I remember correctly, you're still working around the front. Now, in the pattern, it said that if you are using a self-striping yarn to keep the stripes going, you should work from the inside and the inside. If you're working from the outside on the sock, that when you do the heel, you should work from the inside. I wasn't that particular about whether or not the stripes line up because on my fish lips, kiss you, I'll never be able to say that. They don't really line up perfectly, like when I do an afterthought heel or something, and I'm fine with that. I don't really care. But I thought this lined up pretty well. I mean, that's the front of the sock. So I was pretty okay with that. So that's the first sock, and I did start the second one last night. So I have a wee little sock here. But my typical German twisted cast on, and I think these will probably likely match up at least up until the heel. We can see, sort of. Here, we'll turn this around. Maybe it'll match better on the other side. There you go. Close enough. Anyway, so that's okay. The ball of yarn just fell underneath the table and rolled all the way across. Now, obviously, if I yank it, it's going to just completely unwind. So I think I'm just going to put this aside. This is going to be one of those episodes. Yeah. Okay, we've already dropped the glasses. Now we've dropped the yarn. Moving right along. The other thing that I have been knitting consistently on and really trying to get done is the Hohe Mystery Wrap knit along. And I know the fifth clue came out. I'm not even going to give a spoiler alert because she actually did now. If you look up the starting point, which is the name of the wrap, the actual picture comes up. So it's not really a mystery anymore, except for those of us that are bringing up the rear. But I did make good progress on it. Let me take out the part that I've. It's done in two pieces, and obviously in clue five, she shows you how you're going to join them, and it's not. My dread was that we were going to have to Kitchener this whole thing together, and I was like, Lord, please. But it's not. It's actually done in a very unique way, which takes the chevrons in a different direction. I won't give too much away, but it's really, really, really nice. So I have been working on clue three. There are five clues. This is finished from clue three. Okay, so this is the part that I have finished. Okay, and you can see it's already pretty big, and I have not obviously blocked it or finished it. This last clue was a twisted rib. There's an eyelet section in there because every one of the colors or designs sections, because these last four have been each of the four colors separated by this eyelet lace. So this eyelet lace is also separating this rib, but you can't really tell because it's the same color. And then there's another little twisted rib section in there and a very small lace section in there. And I believe there's two lace sections. And I believe there's more lace coming up in further sections. But anyway, this is the completed up to clue three half. And I am working on clue three on the second piece because you have to do the same thing on each of the two halves up until you get up to clue five, which is the clue that joins the halves. So this is where I'm at. That's the right side on clue three on my second half. And I have to say, I am loving the colors. I really, really, really think that these colors went together beautifully. Now, I cannot take credit. I really can't. I gotta be honest. Three of them were in a kit that was for something else. which is this one, and this speckled one. So all I had to add to it was this sort of off-white natural color, which was a no-brainer, and this golden color, which, you know, was picked up in here. So I did not have to think. I didn't have to really, you know, add too much of my own pathetic color sense. So I don't take credit for the fact that the colors seem to go together really well, but I am very, very happy with the color choices. So that, again, glasses that should be on my face that are on the table. So I'm really, really pleased with the way this is coming out. And that is the Hohe Locatelli. It was the mystery knit along, but I believe now if you look up, it's called Starting Point. And again, I will link that in the description box below. So that is really all I have been working on knitting wise. Let me just show you my knitting finished object, which happens to be my May socks. And that is these. I did do a fish lips kiss heel on them. And again, you know, I mean, the heel part, I mean, to me, it's stripes. Does it match? I don't know. There's probably a little break in the actual striping there. To me, I, you know, if it's not covered in ketchup, I'm not going to notice it. So it doesn't bother me at all. This colorway is called Boot Scootin'. It is an older colorway. It was actually inspired by a friend of mine, Marion. She's Marion One on Ravelry. And it was inspired for Susan of Desert Vista Dye Works to dye for a previous SSK event from several years back now. I think it was 2 years ago, 3 years ago by now. So it's an older color. But I love them. They fit great. I'm really happy with them. And again, that's my one and only finished object. So that's it for knitting. We are going to be moving on to spinning. And I have been spinning slash fiber obsessed. I don't know why. I had stopped for so long. I don't know why my wheels were sitting. And I guess maybe I had fallen in a rut. I mean, that's really what it came down to, is I was spinning things, Navajo plying them, spinning things, Navajo plying them. And it was kind of like, you know, how much of this can you do? I mean, I'm not really learning anything and I'm not really applying myself. I can't say I'm not learning anything, because I took classes with J.C. Boggs and I did learn different drafting techniques, different art yarn techniques. And again, I enjoyed it and I might try it at some point, but I don't really knit with art yarn, so it wasn't too practical. But then I decided, you know, I'm going to step outside my box and I'm going to try different drafting techniques. And I also had a lot of fleece that I decided I was going to try processing different ways and spinning different ways, because now I didn't have to worry about color. The color was taken out of it. The fleece that I have is either white, or I have that chocolate brown, which I believe I had shown, and I think I had shown it washed in a previous podcast. So I decided I was going to do some experimenting with that, because number one, I had so much of it, and number two, this thing is going to keep dinging, but only because I don't know how to shut it off. And that's what I've been doing. So let's get started. Let me start off by showing you. I had shown, I don't know if, I believe it was in the last podcast, I had purchased a brown cordial fleece. And I did show it washed, a big bucket of it. And I also had shown that when I went to Maryland Sheep and Wool, I had purchased a pair of combs. Now, I did have a pair of Viking two-pitch combs, but I purchased a set of five-pitch English combs from Indigo Hound. And I decided I was going to try combing some of this cordial, which I did. And it combed just beautifully. I don't know if you can see it really from here, but this is it, essentially comb top. And I did start spinning some of it. It drafts beautifully. It's, again, this is considered a medium fiber. So with cordail, you could easily put it through the carder and come out with a beautiful prep for woolen spun. But because it is medium to the medium fine, not to the medium coarse, you can also hand comb it, and this combed beautifully. But I will say there was a lot of waste. However, I have all the waste saved and will probably go through it and see, put some of it through the drum carder and see what comes out. If it comes out full of pills and naps and stuff I don't want to spin, then I'll end up chucking it. And that's the thing with hand combing, is that you can expect a lot more waste than you do with drum carding. And the other thing, what was I going to say? Oh, with 5-pitch combs, I believe you're going to get even a little bit more waste than you would with 2-pitch or single-pitch combs, because you're really, it's really meant for fine wool, and it's really meant to get the top, the real top of the fiber. And that's why pretty much it's called comb top, because it pulls out the best of the best of the fleece, and the rest is waste. Now, waste in the sense of it's not the prime of the fiber, but that doesn't mean that it's garbage. You can put it through the drum carder and spin it differently. Not in the same yarn, though. Okay, so in other words, what I would hand comb would make one kind of yarn. I would not add to that yarn what I put through the drum carder. That would be a different yarn, and likely I would woolen spin that, whereas this I would spin in a worsted style since it's combed, and it would make an entirely different yarn. So this is again the comb, the top that I've been combing. I do have quite a bit of it combed and quite a bit of it left to comb. So we've been working on that. And the other thing I did was I had purchased a Cormo fleece at Maryland Sheep and Wool. And I didn't even realize until I unrolled the sheep and found the thing in the center that it was from Rupert's Farm, which, if you are a spinner, you may be familiar with Rupert's. They are known for their cordail and their Cormo fleeces, and they do a pretty amazing job of skirting their fleeces. Their fleeces are coated. They generally produce very, very beautiful fleeces. And I knew when I saw this fleece that this fleece was gorgeous. I just didn't realize it was from them, which doesn't really make any difference where it was from. It just was a beautiful fleece. So what I did this time, and I've learned from having done other fleeces. I mean, I've done fleeces where my first ones where I took the bag and just started pulling out handfuls and then couldn't understand why it wouldn't stay in any lock. And since then, I've learned what I do now is I have this plastic, huge plastic tablecloth if I can't go outside. And I roll the fleece out onto this plastic tablecloth. And some fleeces are skirted better than others, which, when you talk, refer to skirted, means that it's the parts that you wouldn't spin, or that are not good, or that are full of stuff, are already removed. That's skirting the fleece, is really basically removing what is unspinnable. And I've seen some fleeces that really were not great, very well skirted. The cordail that I had purchased was nicely skirted. There was not much waste. And I knew when I went to that fleece, I loved the color. I saw a lot of really beautiful locks in there. I knew I did not want to be bothered with the yucky stuff. All right. You can clean it. You can just as easily spin it. But it wasn't what I wanted, and I really didn't want to deal with it. And this was like over a 7-pound fleece, so I wasn't, enough was enough. So I was very happy. I skirted out a lot of that stuff. I mean, dirty tips, sticky tips, tips that are really stuck together, that's fine. You can easily deal with that. I'm talking about the really kind of yucky stuff, the shorter fibers, the leg fibers, things like that. I got rid of it. The cormel fleece, when I opened it up, I couldn't, that was skirted within an inch of its life. I think I removed like a piece that was this big, only because I didn't feel like dealing with it. It was really just filthy dirty. Everything else was like, you've got to, I mean, this is just a part of it. This is some of the locks that I've pulled off, and this is about as dirty as the fleece was. This is pretty much what the rest of the fleece looked like. I was shocked. It was so beautifully skirted. So this, what I've done is I've laid it out, and from each area pulled off locks, okay? Like this. This is unwashed. This is just from what I've pulled off of the unwashed fleece. And I'm going to put it on my table here. But you can see, this is the unwashed fleece. And when it's this gorgeous, when the locks are this beautiful, when they are this really clean, I mean, it's the lanolin is still in there. Obviously, you have to get the lanolin out. I don't want to spin it in the grease. But when it's this nice, you really want to keep the lock formation. It's pretty easy to keep it. Other times, it's a lot harder. This was really easy. So I did some looking into it, and I found I don't know if you call it a DVD. It was a download from Interweave. That's by Margaret Stowe, and I believe it's called Spinning for Lace, or I think it's called Spinning for Lace. And she has a method in there that she recommends on how to wash and keep it in the lock formation. And I decided to go ahead and try that. To me, it looked like it was going to turn into one big massive thing of felt. But again, like I said, if I lost a lock or two, I was not going to cry about it. It was a learning experience. Well, I did it. And essentially what you do is you take each lock, like each one of those locks that I showed you, and you dip it in very hot water, squeeze it, you rub it on a bar of soap, you squeeze it, you dip it back in the rinse water, turn the lock over, and repeat. Set it aside, do that with a bunch of locks. When you've got a bunch of soapy locks sitting on a towel, or I used paper towels, you then take each one, swish it in rinse water, squeeze, swish it the other end in rinse water, squeeze, and that's it. And then you roll it all up in a towel and you let it dry. It worked. Okay. It came out absolutely beautifully. Now, I have to tell you that these were, if you look at the locks, once this tip end, let me take out one of the dirty locks so you can see. The tip end, which is down here, and the cut end, which is here, aren't that different. I mean, usually you will see tip ends that are very, very dirty. They're very stuck together. On this fleece, it wasn't at all. So when I washed it, it was actually harder to tell. Usually you end up having to flick the tip ends open. In this case, I actually really was flicking open the cut end, which is this one, if you can see, because that was actually more stuck together than the tip end was. But they washed up beautifully. There is no felting at all. I've now washed quite a few of these locks and have been spinning them. Say when I wash this is how much it poofed up from this lock, this dirty lock. I would take this in half. Each one that I wash, I would do about a finger's width, no more. You don't want your fibers to get tangled. You don't want to be handling a wet big mess of fibers. So that's how I ended up doing it, and it washed up beautifully. And I have been spinning it directly from the lock. I have not had to comb it. I have not put it through the carder. Now I will say, and I think I've shown before, I'm going to be showing it now. I have it finished. I had done a cormel fleece before, which I had put through my drum carder. and you will see how it spun up. I have finished. I still have a ton of it left to spin, but I actually ended up taking some of the bobbins and plying them to get it off the bobbins and get it done. And I will show you. That is a totally carded prep. And what that caused was a lot of neps in it, a lot of noils, which I did end up pulling out, but it wasn't, I thought the fiber deserved better. This, you can see, there is nothing in here. It is just beautiful blocks that are ready to spin. And that's what I've been doing. And I have been spinning from the tip end. And I can't remember what her, it has to do with the way that the scales lie. And then when you go to ply it, the way that the ply will, because of the scales, will hold the fiber better. And I'll have to get back in my next, you know, the next time I record, I will explain, be able to explain it better. But there is a reason for spinning from the tip, and I don't want to give the wrong information. But she also did show a little trick that works when you have a lock. And that is how to tell, because on this one, again, it's pretty difficult to tell which is the tip and which is the cut end. And the thing of it is, if you do that, your finger will always go to the tip end because of the way that the scales in the fleece are. So if you take it and you just rub your fingers, it's always going to go to the tip end, and you can see that is actually the tip end. So that's just an interesting thing. If you have locks and you want to spin from the tip and you're not sure which end is the tip, that's an easy way to tell. You just hold your lock in the center, you go like that, and your fingers will always go to the tip end. So that's been pretty helpful for me, because again, I can tell because it's actually the cut end that I've had to flip card open to spin from. I have been, and that's why this lock is kind of like apart, I've been literally breaking this down and spinning it in small bits to try to keep it aligned. Again, it is not cone top. This is spinning from the lock, so you're not going to get the same alignment as you would from a comb top, but you're going to get a pretty beautiful, beautiful yarn. Here's what I did. I wanted to do some samples, which is something I never did. I usually just spin, ply, and I'm done. But this time I decided I really want to do justice to this fiber because it is so beautiful, so I wanted to make some samples and see how it is that I want to spin this. Now, I think this little sample here, this is a two ply. And I don't know if I washed this one. I think I did. But as you can see, maybe I didn't wash it. And that's why, but it's not a balanced yarn, okay? And where I've been running into trouble, I think, is overspinning and underplying. And I can show you that in these other two skeins, which I did wash. Okay, and sampled. I believe, again, this one is a two ply. And I'm going to hold it up and see if you can, let's see if it'll focus for one thing. Okay, I mean, to me, it looks like right here would be fine. This part, just pick that one out there, would be fine. But this was not spun consistently, and I think that was my problem. And I think largely what I did here was overspin and underply. And what ended up, it resulted in a more or less balanced yarn. You can still see it is still over a bit over twisted. Well, actually, it's not. It's more or less balanced. But from the look of the yarn, I'm not as happy with it. So we kept on experimenting and took it a little further. Here is another skein. Which I think came out a little bit more consistent. It's not quite as over twisted, but I think again this is still a little bit underplied. Now the strange thing is, I keep going up pulley sizes because to try and change your treadles when you're looking to change the amount of twist in your yarn is not a good idea. It's kind of like saying, well, I'm not going to gauge when I'm knitting, so I'm going to knit looser, which is a very hard thing to do to consistently knit differently. Whereas if you just changed your needle size, you would not have to change the way you knit. You would knit the way you always knit and you would get gauge. That's the same thing with changing your pulley. If you find you're getting too much twist, go up a pulley size. If you find you're getting too little twist, go down a pulley size. Then your treadling stays the same, everything stays the same, except the amount of twist that you're getting in the yarn. And the funny thing is that, lace weight yarn, you have lace flyers, you have very thin, very small lace, super high speed pulleys, and that's I was what I was using. So I backed down. And I'm now currently on the medium pulley, on the larger size on the medium pulley, and somehow it's still getting up over twisted, and I'm not a fast treadler. So I have to look into that and examine it a little bit further. I will be doing another sample with this, but that's the upshot of this. And it's kind of almost strange to me because when I do my normal spinning, I spin a single, which comes to really a lace weight, and I Navajo ply it, and all is well with the world. I end up with a balanced yarn. So I'm not sure if it's because I'm spinning from the lock and maybe, the constant joins, maybe that's affecting it. But at any rate, these are the samples that I got. Are they usable? Absolutely. I'd like to get a little more consistency in it. It's not exactly the yarn that I want yet. So I will continue to sample from this Cormo. And again, I've got a lot more to wash. I have a lot of locks that are ready to be spun. So there's some playtime there in that. So that's what I'm currently working on. I have a fiber optic gradient on my Lendrum, which I didn't take off. It's really not much to show. I will spin it, Navajo apply it, keep the gradient, move it along. And on my Sidekick, I am spinning up more of the Cormo that I carded. And since I have some of it here to show you, I didn't take that off the wheel either. But this is a very large skein. I don't have, I am looking, I'm actually in the market. If anybody knows of a good one, I've been doing some research. I haven't really found anything that is ringing my bells yet, but I am looking for a yarn skeiner and a yardage meter because I'm doing these, winding, skeining these on Knitty Natties and kind of guessing at the yardage. You count the skeins, and but it's not really accurate because when you wash it, it poofs up. And so I'm kind of looking for a yardage skeiner with a yardage meter. I can't speak. And I have apparently a very unhappy dog up there. This, and I'm not sure what this big fat thing here is. Why did I tie it across the skein? I'm just going to rip it off. This is Cormo. The weight of this skein is 4.3 ounces. This is the fleece that I carded, and I spun it woolen. And again, I have a ton more of this. This is nowhere near finished being spun, but this is what I have so far. It's a pretty balanced yarn. This is a two ply. I did spin this. I don't know if I mentioned because my mind is going. I spun it woolen. And I have absolutely no idea how many yards there are here. So I'm going to say there's a lot because it's a pretty thick skein and there's 4 ounces here of two plies. So I'm going to say it's a good amount of yardage. And again, I will have more. But I'm really happy with how this came out. I think it, the woolen, it kept it nice. It is nice and poofy. What I like is that you can see there is some spring in this yarn. There's elasticity in here, which, let me see if I can, you can see when I pull on it that there is a lot of elasticity and bounce in the yarn, which is nice. And that's part of what I like about woolen spun yarns is that they are not stiff. This is a very soft yarn. I think it's actually for a woolen spun two-ply. I think this will end up being pretty durable. Would I make socks out of it? No. But I think this will make a really, really nice lace shawl. So, again, this is the Cormo that I will skein this up later, that I carded and spun that up. Okay, moving along. I have two skeins that I did and finished that typical. These are Navajo plied. They're Into the World. This one is called Andraste. It is a 50-50 merino bombix silk. And here's what I got out of this. Again, I can't tell you on yardage, but that's what I got. And I really, really love the colors. Which is why I really like Navajo plying, because I never liked barber pulling, but you'll see in a minute, I might be changing my mind on that one. But this is one skein. I'm trying to work my way through my massive stash of Into the World, which is why I will likely be spinning on their team for Tour de Fleece. Because once I spin up and, you know, get my stash down to a reasonably normal size, then I can rejoin her club and get more. Of course, why not? So that is one finished spinning that I did. And then I thought I had shown this in a previous podcast, but apparently I didn't. If I did, I'm sorry for showing it again. This is also Into the World. It is the 221B colorway. Maybe I showed it while it was in progress. But anyway, it is 60-20-20 merino yak and silk. I spun this on my flat iron, and this says 446 yards. I know how I did that. This one I did by that yarn scale thing. I don't know if any of you have seen them. It's a balance, and it's essentially what it gives you is the grist, which is the yards per pound. And then from that, you weigh your skein and calculate out how much yardage you actually have in your skein. Would I base a project on it? No, I probably wouldn't. I'd want something a little bit more accurate than that. But anyway, this is what I got. This is 221B from Into the World. Again, it's chain plied. Spun on my flat iron. I enjoyed spinning it. I love the colors. I'd love to know how much I actually have here before I pick something to knit with it. It's really, really soft. The merino, yak, and silk is a great combination to spin. This is from her, actually, I don't think this is from her club. This I must have purchased either at Rhinebeck or Into the World. I probably saw the purple and gray and lost it, and that was that. Fell down that rabbit hole. But anyway, that's that. And then my last spinning project is something that is really outside of my box. I decided to go into my stash and pick something that was different, that was not, it was definitely colored top, but it wasn't like sections where you would want to Navajo ply it and keep it together. There really wasn't any way to do it because the color sections were so short. So I'm thinking, all right, what am I going to do with this to kind of keep it? Because I have tried splitting braids in half and plying them on two bobbins and, you know, spinning them on two bobbins, plying them together, and ended up with just sort of muddy kind of colors, and I didn't want that. So I said, you know, I'm going to look into fractal spinning. And see how that works out. So I looked at different methods of fractal spinning, and fractal basically is based on a math term of fraction. And there isn't, from what I gathered, and this is just from the research that I've done, there isn't really a right or a wrong way to fractal spin. It's just that you do it in fractions. In other words, you're going to split your fiber in half. One of the halves, you're going to spin from end to end. The other half, you're going to break into fractions. You can break it into two pieces and spin them end to end. You spin one, and then you spin directly from the other. Or you can spin it into more. You can split it into more. I split my second half into four sections that I then spun end to end. So I ended up with two bobbins, one which was half the fiber, spun straight end to end, one which was then divided down further into four sections, and I spun each of those four sections end to end and then plied it together. And I was really, really pleased, and I have to say pretty surprised with the results. This is what I got from it. I really now wish I had taken a picture of the fiber beforehand. So note to self, from now on, before you do something like this, take a picture of the fiber. Because even though there is barbapolin, which I am fine with, there are also sections where the colors did match up beautifully, which primarily is the lightest of the colors, which is nice, which is this tealy green. So you have that pop. But the colors, as much, you know, where, oh gosh, now look, well, there went one lock. That did not go well. Okay. The colors really stayed vibrant. Let's just stick this out of here. You can see each of the colors, and that's what I wanted. I didn't want, I'm trying to get it where the light can really catch it. I mean, you can see the orange, you can see the green, you can see the burgundy. And then they blended well together. And I think even though there is some barbapoling in it, it barbapoled with like and similar colors, which I think once it's knit, it will knit up really, really nicely. So I have to say, this may be a technique that I will use again in the future. I was very, very happy with it. I, again, have no idea how many yards I got from this. I really am, like, actively looking for a yardage meter, if not even a scanner. I don't really mind using the Nitty Natty. I just need to be able to run it through a yardage meter, either as I'm doing it, I guess you'd have to do it as you're doing it, because I wouldn't want to do it when it's skeined, because then I couldn't, you know, if I gifted it or gave it or sold it or whatever, I couldn't tell somebody accurately how much yardage accurately was in there. Just so you know, this fiber is from, sorry, this fiber, I was in the Be Myself, which I thought is so cute, Be Myself Fiber Club in 2015. So this has been sitting around for a while, but that's, this fiber is from Be Myself, and it is actually superwash targi, which is really enjoyable to spin. I don't know if I've spun targi before. I think I have, but I don't remember, and I think, you know, where it is now, you can really get a much better look at the colors and the fact that there is just no muddying of them. I'm shocked. I'm really, really surprised at how much I like this skein. I've never really been a fan of barbapoling and that kind of stuff because I've never had success with it. It's always been muddy when I did it. But I'm really, really happy with how this came out, so I just digressed. the name of the color is Seed Pods, and again, it is from Be Myself. There's no weight on here, so I'm not sure what the weight of the skein is, but whatever. Probably about 4 ounces, I'm pretty sure. But it feels like I'm not going to crinkle. I think I've made enough problems today. Okay, here we go. So we're going to move one pile of mess over. And we're going to move into some stash enhancement. So if you are familiar with the Desert Vista Dye Works sock club, for each 6 months, no, I'm sorry, 3 months that you complete. So in other words, if you did January, February, and March, at the end of March, sometime in April, she sends you a coupon code for a 30% discount off your next order from her shop. If you finish 6 consecutive months, from January through June, you get either a coupon for 30% off your next order or a free skein of yarn. And then again, 3 months down the line, if you've done another 3 months, you get 30% off. And if you did all 12 months by the end of the year, you get a free skein of an exclusive colorway that she does just for the sock club for that year. Well, in May, June, March, April, I'm sorry, I got my coupon code. Let's just leave it at that. And I figured, well, I'm knitting up so much. Not that I don't have a huge stash already, but I did get a 30% discount and I did need to replenish my stash. So I got a few skeins from Desert Vista Dye Works. So, what I got, okay, what I got was, oh, actually, this one, every month, Susan has a thread on her, in her forum on Ravelry, for a contest to name a colorway. And the theme, I think it was 2 months ago, I'd have to check, was chick flicks. So I had posted a picture and suggested Thelma and Louise, and lo and behold, she chose that as one of the three that she picked, so she sent me a free skein of Thelma and Louise. So this is, and now I have to say, it is showing up more yellowy. This is definitely a golden orange and blues. And I love it so much. So that's one skein that I got. I think I had forgotten to show it in the previous podcast, but that is a skein she sent me. I also got, I purchased Unicorn Frap. Are you sensing a pink theme with the socks I'm working on now and this one? So I got Unicorn Frap. Let me put them all back in the stack, because like I said, if I don't do this in an organized way, everything's going to fall over. So we're going to put Thelma in there. And then I got two, I'm sorry, I'm crinkling away here. Okay. I'm done crinkling. Okay. I got Bing and the Andrew Sisters. I just went crazy for this colorway. I just thought it was absolutely adorable. And I think this is the colorway that Laura is currently knitting on her socks for this month. I was watching their podcast yesterday, and I think she said it reminded her of a pencil, like a lead pencil. And the more I look at it now, it does. It reminds me of a pencil. So I kind of can't wait to knit this one up. But I absolutely love the colorway, so I got that one. And then, last but not least, I got Candyland, which I didn't even realize. I mean, I just see colors and, like, that's fine. I love it. I'm going for it. I didn't realize that you get an extra skein for your heels and toes. Now, I don't even know if this is one skein or two separate skeins. I think this is just one skein for heels and toes. But how cute is that? I mean, just how cute is that? I love it. I am loving this. So I'm pretty well set for the next few months for my Specificity Dye Works sock knit along. And since hopefully I will get my June socks done on time, I will either get another skein or 30% off another order. So I will be very well set with Desert Vista Dye Works. I also ordered, and this is because I decided, I think I'm going to go on, now that everyone is done knitting it and moved on to her new one, I'm going to, I think, knit the Find Your Fade shawl. I think for the fall, I think it will be great to wrap up in, but I have a lot of hedgehog fibers because I joined their Skinny Singles Club twice. And again, we had that debacle with those bad colors that I chose for the poor Stephen West knit along. There's, it's still sitting. I know I'm going to have to throw out the knitted part. But I do have the Skinny Singles and some of the other precious skeins that I used in that. I do have what's left from it, so I don't think I have to have exact amounts. The upshot of this whole long diatribe is that I got two colors that I saw on Eat Sleep Knit, I think, and I thought they were just gorgeous. And I got these to go into that because the ones, the Skinny Singles that I have from Hedgehog Fibers are much more intense. They have more pops of color, they're darker, they're brighter, they're just more intense. And I thought these two subtle ones would add to it. As opposed to trying to match up solids in there, I thought if I picked two colored, very subtle ones, that would blend in really, really well. And a lot of the ones I have pinks and purples, so I knew that they would go. So this one is Cheery Hedgehog Fiber Skinny Singles in Cheery, and I believe I got this from Eat Sleep Knit, this one as well. This is the same Skinny Singles, and it is called, I hope I didn't break my glasses because I can't see, Daydream. This one is called Daydream. So I got that. And then I'm actually going to call this a spoiler alert because I don't know that everybody got theirs. And I know that there are no pictures yet posted except under spoiler, which, by the way, if you are a Ravelry user, there, Casey has come up with a new way for you to post a spoiler in your post. And what it does is it comes up as this bar that says spoiler and has a little container of popcorn. And if you click on that picture, then the spoiler picture will pop up. And I'm going to explain how you do it. You can look in the For Love of Ravelry thread. It's listed there. But essentially what you do is you put three or more colons, as long as you put three colons. Then you go to the, you know, hit enter, go to the next, whatever, and you put your picture. Then you go under the picture and put three more colons. And if you hit preview, all you're going to see is that bar that says spoiler and a little thing of popcorn. So you can put a spoiler into your thread, into your post, without actually anybody seeing it unless they click on it. Now, having said that, I would not do that in a thread that says no spoilers, a specific thread that says no spoilers, because somebody could see that, accidentally click on it, not know that that's what it meant, and obviously be spoiled. But if you want to show something that, like in this particular thread, it didn't say no, it actually says contains spoilers, but you don't want to be the one that shows it or whatever, there is a way to hide your pictures unless somebody actually clicks on where it says spoiler. Just thought I'd share with the class. So anyway, here is a spoiler alert. This is from the 7-year club. I don't want to say club. It was a 7-year, what did they call it? It was sort of like a 7-year thing that the Knit Girls did. Kit. It was a 7-year kit that they had a limited number of, and If you were really fast to the draw, you were able to get in on it. And I will show you what I got. Again, spoiler, if you did purchase yours and have not gotten it yet, I will do the jazz hands when it's all put away and safe. But what was included in it was a bag. Why do I not uncrinkle this stuff beforehand? I'm actually not even gonna uncrinkle it. Here is the bag. Okay, I think I don't want to speak out of turn. I don't know if this is exclusive. I'm not sure. I'm not sure if this is exclusive fabric for them. But the bag is by Twist. I knew I'm gonna end up crinkling anyway. She's just taking it out of the gum. Twist bags. Okay, so we got this really beautiful bag. It's nice and squishy. It's padded on the inside, has a handle. So that was in there. Then also, we got a skein called the 7 Year Itch, the Knit Girls. It's an exclusive colorway. I believe it is exclusive. Well, as Leslie put it, which was really funny, it's exclusive to the kit, but Susan owns the rights, so she can do whatever she wants with it. So I don't know if she will come out with more if we can possibly beg and plead with her to make more skeins of this. But for right now, this is the colorway that came in the 7 Year kit from the Knit Girls. It is on her Viso base, and I do believe this is self-striping. So I'm interested to see how this is going to stripe, but I do love the colorways. So that was in the kit as well. And then the Knit Girls put in some swag, some Knit Girl swag. Amazing. Amazing. I don't know how these girls keep outdoing themselves. I really don't. These two stickers, which are so adorable. I would bet anything that Becky of Gustler Designs did the amazing artwork on this. Isn't that adorable? I think that is just so cute. So that was in there. And there was a lip balm from Tufts Woolens, and it's called Celebrating 7 Years, 7 Years with the Knit Girls. I'm guessing from what other people have posted that there were different flavors. I'm not sure. Mine is vanilla, which is fine. I love vanilla. And I love Tufts Woolens. I've used their soap. I have used their lip balm. I have used their hand stuff. I love Tufts Woolens. So that was great. A pen, which also doubles as a stylus, was included in there. So that was another thing included. A Knit Girls carabiner with a measuring tape on it, which you can never have enough of. And if you clip it onto something, you won't be caught without a measuring tape, and you're doing your socks, and you're at the point where you need to measure for the heel, and you don't have a measuring tape. So that's always good to have. And they included another bag. Can you believe this? They included another bag with that design on there, which again, I would just bet money that Becky, Laura's sister from Gessler Designs, did. In fact, I think that they mentioned it on their podcast. I don't remember. I was so busy writing down exactly when they were going to go on sale that I just wasn't even paying attention anymore. I was too busy just going for it. So, but they did include this really large, beautiful tote bag, which I thought was just so nice and so generous of them. The Knit Girls, which, I'm going to skip before I finish off stash enhancement to upcoming events. I'm going to SSK in July, and I have been fortunate, literally fortunate, lucky enough to have gone to all five. This will be my sixth one. I've been able to go to all of them. And I can say from personal experience, and I'm going to get gushy here now for a minute, these girls do not do anything partway. I don't know how they do it. I don't. I only know that I can tell from personal experience that they do it out of love, because it is a labor of love. Everything they do from the heart. And you can see it in the kit. It was not half done. It was not part done. It's like they give and then they want to give a little bit more. So if you've never had the chance to go to SSK, please keep, and you're interested, it's July, I think it starts the 19th and runs to the 23rd. And there may still be spots that come up. If you check on the Knit Girls Retreats board, there may be spots that still open up to the public. I can't recommend it highly enough. I really can't. Obviously, I would not have gone 5 years and be going now for my sixth year in a row if I didn't love it, I didn't find it valuable, wonderful, a fabulous experience, the classes, the teachers, the caliber of teachers they have. But it all comes down to the fact that they put their heart and soul into everything they do, especially the retreat. They will bend over backwards to make you happy and to see that you have a good time and enjoy it and make friends and make the most of it. So I'm sorry, I had to get that out there. I said it. It's out there. I'm heading on. You know I love you girls. And I cannot wait to see you in July. Moving on. I don't even know what I'm going to do with all these bags. I am part of Miss Babs Knitting Tour. I did 2016. I am in it again 2017. And one thing she offered this year, if you wanted to purchase, was she had a bag designed with the 2017 logo on it. I see bag. I see this style bag. And don't ask me twice. I am on board. So that came this week. So, and the inside, actually, this is really cute. I didn't turn it inside out. I know this podcast is like probably running into like an hour now, and I'm still blathering on. But it's got knitting needles, airplanes. I mean, how cute is that? Because the whole theme is travel. And she, if you've never heard of the knitting tour from Miss Babs, she's another one, puts heart and soul into this knitting tour. It's a yearly thing. You get 4 shipments, and each shipment takes you to a different place. And you get yarn, a stitch marker that matches the theme, a pattern that goes with the yarn, but you're not obligated to do the pattern. It's a yarn. It's not some strange yarn. It's one of her yarns, but it's an exclusive colorway, so you can knit pretty much whatever you like with it. And a beautiful, beautiful booklet that describes the place that you've gone to. There's usually some candy related to your destination in there. So that's a fun thing. And the last thing that I have, I promise, is if any, I'm sure you're all familiar with the brand Yarn Pop. Okay. This, I don't even know what they call this bag other than I call it huge. Okay. It's the one with the 3 grommets in the front, and this one has pockets on the inside, comes with the handle. The handle can be put on the zipper so that you can kind of angle it and knit as you go. You can also put the handle here. And just in case you were wondering, because I know I sure was, if you put the yarn through this, how do you zip it closed? Because the yarn's going to be on the outside. They thought of that. And the zipper, when you close it, has a gap and a little padding so that you have room to have your yarn come out without getting snagged. I just got this. I did get another one. And the reason I am passing this information along is because Yarn Pop, at their website, yarnpop.com, is having a warehouse clearance sale. These bags are 50% off. So if you know what Yarn Pop bags usually go for, to get the they're not seconds, they're not, you know, bad bags, they're just patterns that they're discontinuing. And to get them at 50% off, that is a pretty good deal. So I did leave a few for you on the site. At least there were some left last night when I checked. So if you are interested in a Yarn Pop bag and were never able to get it before, check out their site. Again, it is a warehouse clearance site. There are a lot of bags that are on clearance, 50% off. I didn't even pay shipping. But I guess they had free shipping because it didn't come to some big amount that would give you free shipping. But so give it a try if you're interested in it. I happen to see, again, pink, and, well, that was it down the rabbit hole. So I think I have blathered on long enough. I think I went through everything on the table. Again, I am going to try to record more often. I know there's been like these big gaps, and I hate that. I really, the episodes wouldn't be this massive if I would just sort, well, maybe they would be if I did a lot of stuff and recorded more often, but I don't think that's going to happen. I'm either going to record more often, have less to show, or record, take too long, and have these massive episodes. But, jazz hands in case. Sorry, I forgot. Okay, well, the spoiler's behind us. And with that faux pas, I think I'm going to say have a wonderful weekend. Happy Father's Day to all of the fathers, to anyone who has a father, who is married to a father, to all men who have fur babies and are fathers, to all the men out there. Have a wonderful Father's Day. Have a wonderful weekend, and I hope I will see you soon. And until I do, remember to knit with sense.